Hello and a very warm welcome to Straight Drive. It's the day of the second semi-finals and the first one, you just saw it, and England triumphed against South Africa to go into the final of the ICC World T20. And here's the results then. The England women, too hot to handle for South Africans, and 101 is what South Africa managed, and England in the end eased to victory. And the ladies of England will be playing Australia, and that's a repeat of the 2012 edition of the ICC World T20. So let's see, they just lost by 4-run margin. Let's see what they are up to this time around, and that will also be coming on Sunday. Now, switching our attention to today's match, and this is the big one, India versus South Africa, the second semi-final, and the winner of this tie will play Sri Lanka in the championship game. So this one is one to watch. It will start in a short while. With me on Straight Drive, it is Ms. Baul Haq and Bazid Khan. How do you see this one coming? First of all, we'll hope that the rain stays away.
Yeah, it's really important, especially South Africa. They'll be really praying that the rain should just stay away. So they really could have a chance to play the game and just get into the finals, because it's like a nightmare type of situation for them. Normally they just can't go before further to the finals in the previous tournament. Yeah. So they will be really hoping that at least they have the game so they can really go there and just try to win this semi-final.
Yeah, Misbah is making a point, Bazid, because if there is rain, then India go through because they were the table toppers. Coming on to India's preparations here, they should be really happy that Yuvraj is back to full fitness after that niggle with the ankle during the football match that they were playing between each other. So he is back to full fitness. That should be good omen for India.
Yes, very much so. Yuvraj, a little scare after that wonderful innings that he played. So everything is going well for India in that regard. Everything is come into place. The tournament, their progression can't be sort of question at any point. They had smooth sailing, and now that Yuvraj also fit too, so all the team combination, everything's coming to plan for India. So everything's looking up for India before the semi-final.
And the journey has been a smooth affair. And let's see that how they have gone about their business in Bangladesh. They beat Pakistan easily. They similar treatment to the West Indies. Then they were too good for Bangladesh, and then Australia as well, a comfortable victory. So, Misbah, it has been a very, very comprehensive outing for India so far.
Yeah, they've been really playing some good cricket, because all their bowlers are really bowling well. And bowling is a big bit of worry for them in previous tournaments and past, that normally they don't just really put their performances when India need them. But in this tournament, the way their bowling is just doing, that's wonderful. They are really restricting some of the top sides, top batting lineups up to a score which is really achievable for these Indian batting this Indian batting lineup. And they have, everybody knows that the kind of quality they have in their batting lineup. Once their bowling is firing, then it's really easy for them to win against any side in the world. So right now, I think they are really playing good cricket in all the departments. So they are the favourites.
Yeah, we'll discuss in detail what has ticked for India later on. Let's see how South Africa has gone about their business here. South Africa, they lost to Sri Lanka. That was a very closely fought game there. In fact, then they come against New Zealand. That's another cliffhanger. The Netherlands also drew them close. And England also, I mean, it's a very contrasting kind of progression from what we see of India here.
Yes, completely different progressions for both the teams. India sailing through and South Africa scrapping and sort of having to rely on some brilliant performance by Steyn, sometimes by Imran Tahir, sometimes by AB de Villiers. So it's been a rocky road for them, and it's not associated with South Africa. It's more associated with the Asian side coming to a semi-final. Mm. Normally South Africa go really well throughout the group stage, get to the semi-final and stumble. So hopefully they've stumbled before the semi-final this time, and their progression towards the semifinals, they might think that is this time it's for them, the World Cup is to be had. And because they've done the hard yards in the group stage and come through, maybe they'll take that positive into the semifinal.
Sometimes it happened in the history of World Cups, if you just go back in even T20 World Cups and then in the 50 years World Cup, the teams winning those World Cups have these sort of situations in during their
finishes.
So let's see how they go and how this match will really go, because it's going to be really interesting.
But the good thing has been that in all the nail-biting finishes, or most of them apart from Sri Lanka, they have found themselves at the right side of the result. Just check out how both teams have been gearing up ahead of this semi-final.
South Africa's date with semi-finals hasn't quite been a love affair, if history is anything to go by. 1992, 1999, 2000, 2006 and 2007 are just a few instances where they have choked. Their captain Faf du Plessis, however, has deflected the pressure in the direction of his opponents.
We felt a couple of times like that before when we felt it was our time. But to be honest with you, India is still, you know, if you look at the tournament, they're still regarded as one of the favourites. And we've played pretty much the whole tournament as underdogs, as you could call it like that. No one really gave us a chance. So what we've been doing is we've been playing really well as a team. We've had different guys performing in every single game.
The Indian camp, though, has shrugged off the favourites tag, although their form in this event has been sparkling. The Blue Brigade have won 4 out of 4, and their powerful batting lineup hasn't even been tested yet.
I think most of these guys were involved in the Champions Trophy, so that's one experience everybody will draw from. Apart from that, I think the one thing that the young sides will have an advantage over the other team is that we don't have any baggage. We have not lost many big competitions or anything like that, so there will be no scars with us. And we have nothing to lose. As I said, we never walked into this tournament as favourites, and we wouldn't want to be tagged as favourites either. We just go in and enjoy ourselves.
One clear area where India do stand in an advantageous position is the know-how of the conditions in Leedpur. They have played all their matches here, while South Africa will be playing their first one in Dhaka.
It's a huge thing. I mean, obviously the wicket at Dhaka is playing completely different to Chittagong. Whereas we've played all our games there, and India has played all their games here. So definitely from a conditions point of view, they much more used to it than we are. But we've put in some hard practice this week on really abrasive surfaces and making sure that we almost over-practiced against spin the ball, almost spinning too much, so it gets used to the spin.
The semi-final is one hurdle where the South Africans have always stumbled. Will there be a repeat, or will we witness history in the making in this frantic Friday fixture?
And yes, the 4 victories that have come in knockout stages at major tournaments, that includes one day international as well, has been the quarter-final stage. And they have always lost in the semi-final. And when you see they've come against India, they've of course always lost as well, because they have never won a semi-final. What is the mental block, Misbah? Why do you, see a team so talented, and most of the times when they enter an ICC event, they are the favourites, but they just seem to have some kind of a block, or something goes wrong when they enter the semi-finals?
Yeah, sometimes it happens, and that's been happening for a long, long time now. And it automatically comes in your mind as a player, as a team, sometimes that, okay, we are not winning semi-finals, and suddenly you just found yourself in absolute pressure situation that we have to win this, and then you can't execute your skills and you can't express yourself. So I think that's a big issue for them, and they have to address it, and it's a good chance for them the way they are really winning the game, so they can prove that we are not that sort of team and we're going to win this. So they need a win to just get out of that. It's like the way Pakistan been just losing to India in all the World Cup matches. Sometimes it happens, and it's really difficult to break that. And once you break that, then I think it's easy in the coming, in the future, especially to just go about those sort of things. But it's there. At the moment, it's there, and it will be in their minds.
And was it they've changed a lot of coaches as well over the years? They've tried Gary Kirsten too, who was extremely successful with India. Of course, he led them to a World Cup victory. But that seems to have not worked for them. Is the problem deeper than what it seems?
Well, they have to carry all this baggage of all, not only themselves, but the teams who have lost in the semifinals before that. I always look back to that 1992 World Cup when they were on course to win the game and then rain came and it was never meant to be. And from then onwards, apart from that one, they won in the inaugural Champions Trophy. Hmm. Otherwise, they've not progressed beyond the semifinal. And extraordinary games. You remember that 99 World Cup game? That was extraordinary. As they couldn't get a single run with, I think, three or four balls. So it's a mental block which only can be sort of erased if they win a game, win a semi-final, win a final. They have to believe that maybe this time it's meant to be. It's just that sort of psychological thing where you think, no, destiny is not in our hands and this is not us, not this time we're not going to win it. But I think maybe because this time around they've not been tags favorites, everybody thought that they won't reach the semi-final, and the way they went about business of reaching the semi-final, maybe that will help them, and I think that might help them in the semi-final.
Okay then, we'll head into a very short break on Straight Drive. When we come back, we continue our build-up. Stay with us. Welcome back to Straight Drive. That's good to see. Not much cloud cover there, and as of now it looks clear. India versus South Africa, and we hope the rain stays away, and they are raining sixes in India versus South Africa. Both teams very, very strong when that comes to batting, and one man who's been extremely strong for India in the batting, let's hear it from him.
Yuvraj, the match against Australia, we saw you after those two sixes against Muirhead overall. You feel you're peaking at the right time in terms of a tournament?
Yeah, definitely. I think it's important to get some runs under the belt and enjoyed spending time in the middle. That was important for me in the last game. So hopefully I can start well again.
Not just the runs with the bat. We saw you a little more mischievous, a little more relaxed. Is that the side of UV that's turned up for the semi-final?
Well, always it's important, you know, in pressure situations to be relaxed. When things are not going well for you, you know, tend to get serious, but the more you relax, the better you'll feel.
Not just the likes of Muirhead, on our side, Mishra, yourself. It's been a tournament where the spinners have played a big part. Today the same.
Yeah, definitely. I think the wickets are getting slower and all the spinners have bowled well. You know, it's important what stage the spinners are coming in also. But I think spinners are going to play a huge role today as well.
Overall, team feeling good?
Yeah, feeling great.
All the best.
Thank you.
That's good to see that he is back to full fitness. Now, India's spinners have been doing the talking at this year's World T20. And of course, South Africa's spinners have been very good too. The overall bowling, if you could see how that have gone about from both the teams, has been exceptional. And that has been one of the reasons that they are in the semi-finals of World T20. I mean, if you see India's bowling in particular, they've been known for their batting. This time, the comprehensive victories that they have registered, I guess we need to say that it has been because of their bowling.
Yes, and surprisingly, although man of the match is also going to the bowlers, the spinners really. And spinners, I think Amit Mishra and Ashwin have been just too hot to handle for other sides. And the ball spinning out of their hand has been a major difference. And even if we see this graphic, it's extraordinary how well they bowl. The economy rates are just superb. Even the strike rates are quite brilliant. And power play economy, 4.50, that's exceptional. So whenever the batsmen are getting after the spinners, they've done brilliantly. And I think Mishra has been a revelation. He hasn't played much cricket, so not a lot of players know about him, know his skill, but he tosses it up. That takes a lot of guts to toss the ball up and then spin it away, make the batsman do all the play and come down the wicket or try to attack him. And that's why he's been so successful. Even Ashwin, to that extent, has slowed it up a bit, which has been the key. And the spinners, I think South Africa also have spinners. India also have spinners. But India's spinners have been far better than, well, exception to Imran Tahir. They have much more a potent spin attack.
I think that's the difference, because South Africa are really limited in terms of spinning department. They only have Imran Tahir, which is which is the kind of bowler who they can really attack with, and he's taking wickets also, and his economy is also good. But if you see on the other side, Indian, all three spinners are attacking spinners. Ashwin, Jadeja, Mishra, they are not only just controlling that scoring rate, but also taking wickets. That's very important. That's where they are really putting pressure on oppositions, because when in T20 cricket on regular basis, every 2-3 overs, you are taking wickets, it automatically affects the scoring rate, and other team is under pressure all the time. And one more thing, their seamers are really bowling well at the top with the new ball. The way they bowl first four overs normally, Ashwin is bowling only two overs in the power play, and rest of the four overs being bowled by the medium pacers.
Bhuvneshwar Kumar in particular has been very good.
They are not giving away anything. Bhuvneshwar Kumar, the control he is showing, swinging the ball both ways, even in the likes of Gale and other top order batsmen against Australia, even the way they bowled, it was really an excellent effort. Not only they pick up wickets, but they haven't allowed them to score quickly in the first six overs. So that's the main difference.
Well, what has Bhuvneshwar done right? What the other seamers from other teams haven't been able to achieve, Bazil?
Well, he's from what I've seen is that he started to pitch the ball a little further up to the batsman. He'd lost his seam, so he was hitting pitch short of length. But this tournament, he's pitched the ball up, and the economy rate 4.33 is because of that new ball swinging both ways. And with Dhoni standing up, it's very difficult to actually for a batsman to make the play. They like to sort of get down the track when it's swinging, but when the keeper's up, then you have very limited options, especially when it's swinging both ways. And Bhuvneshwar has been very consistent with his length and line, in both the outswing and when he's bringing the ball back in. So he's been very consistent. And the most important part is that he's pitching it slightly further up to the batsman, allowing that ball to swing rather than banging it in.
Not only Bhuvneshwar, I mean, if you look at even past, Magra used to do this, hit the seam and just get the ball to move a little bit, and Mohammad Asif used to do it for Pakistan. Even on the slow pitches, he was a kind of bowler who always put batsmen under pressure, even on the flat pitches. So that's what he is doing. He's putting the ball in the right areas where all the time ball just asks questions to the batsman. You can only play with a batter technique, and if you just try to go after that delivery, which is right on that spot, which is, you could say, a blind spot for batsmen, and you don't know which way the ball going to move. And that little bit of movement off the seam and also in the air, that really creates problem for you. And that's what he is doing. His control is, you could say, excellent control at the moment with the new ball.
Okay. Talking of the bowlers then, let's see what the bowlers should expect from the 22 yards out there. It's Shane Warne with the pitch report.
Pitch and weather brought to you by HBL.
Hello and welcome to the middle out here. What have we got in store for this big clash between India and South Africa? Two wonderful teams that have played well in this tournament. The conditions are quite cool. We saw unbelievable storms last night. The outfield's flat and the rain that has not affected the middle whatsoever. Let's have a closer inspection at the pitch. Well, first of all, I can tell you it's absolutely rock hard. It's the fourth game in the tournament so far. There's a few cracks here. They won't come into play. What will come into play with this coarseness of the pitch, the spinners will. We know it's going to spin, and there's some wonderful spinners on display in both teams. So spin to win. I think a good score is going to be around 160, 165 is a par score. Runs on the board in a big game in a semi-final is the key. I think both captains will win the toss and bat. And as I said, it looks an absolute belter. A road, good for batting. Lots of spin, hard work for the quickies.
Pitch and weather brought to you by HBL.
And Shane Warne again reckons that it is a road and very conducive for batting. But he's been saying that for the last three matches, but we are yet to see a road out there, Ms.
Yet to see any sort of spin. Even in the West Indian-Pakistan game, there wasn't any spin. It was slow, but you haven't seen any sort of spin.
Do they change the track after he gives his pitch report?
I don't think so. Because normally what happens in Mirpur, it looks like every time you go out there, it looks like you're going to turn. That's what happened with us even against the Bangladesh in the Asia Cup game. We put another spinner in because the pitch was looking like that it's going to turn a lot. And they scored 320 plus. Mm. And they were just hammering all spinners all around. It wasn't any turn. So yeah. Sometimes it's really difficult to just say anything pitch. About that yeah. pitch, because one day it really start turning and the next day same looks, everything is same, but there is no turn. So, but he's right. Obviously, if it's spin or it's not much of the spin still, I think spin is going to play an important role for India because it's a slow track. And obviously, spinners have a bigger role to play here. And 160, 165 score, if somebody can just put that score. Yeah. In a semi-final, it's always pressure for the team chasing.
Regardless of the track, of course. Apart from giving his lowdowns on the pitch, he's been helping the South African spinners too. How much of an impact would that be in this game for them?
Yes, that's very interesting. He actually made time and went to the ground and helped them out. I think Imran played for Hampshire a few seasons ago, and there I think Shane Warne also helped him. So he likes. He's very vocal in that sense that he likes helping the spinners out. He knows he's been world class spinner. He knows a lot about leg spin as well. But I'm hoping that Imran sort of sticks to his game plan. I don't think he's the type of bowler who can follow Shane Warne's sort of letting the ball give it air. He'll bowl the same way. But I'm sure just having Shane Warne talk to you gives you lots of confidence anyway, because he's a legend. So that'll probably help Imran in that sense, just having a little chat to, even if they were chatting about something irrelevant, but just having a chat with Shane Warne in that regard is a confidence booster.
Come on, he must have gone for something relevant there.
Maybe, I think they're going out for dinner or something, a good place to have fish in Dhaka.
Okay, now the two have been making waves, Amit Mishra and Imran Tahir. It's been a World Cup of spinners so far, and this is what they've been up to. Both very commendable averages there, Misbah. Who do you think is more difficult to pick? You've played against both of them.
I think Mishra got an advantage in that because he's truly a leg spinner, you could say, because he could really turn the ball away from the right-handers. He got the flipper, he got googly also. But Imran Tahir is totally different. If you see, he don't turn the ball really. The kind of turn normally leg spinners have. Yeah. His leg spin is not turning much, and usually he...
And Mishra turns a lot.
Yeah, Mishra turns a lot. He can bowl quicker deliveries, flatter deliveries, and he could really toss the ball up and it just turns a long way. So he got an advantage as a leg spinner because he has more variations even in his leg spin. But Imran Tahir truly just depends on his flippers and the googly.
Whose googly is more deceptive?
I think Mishra have the googly also. He can turn googly also a long way, and he can bowl flipper. Maybe you could say that Imran Tahir is a bit better in terms of flipper, but that he got really good one. And that's the delivery where he's picking up the wickets and really troubling the batsman.
Coming to India's batting now, we've seen that they've been very illustrious, but Shikhar Dhawan has been maybe the weak link at this year's World T20. Do you think he should be opening the batting, or would you bring in Rahane for him?
That's a very interesting question, very difficult question to answer as well, because we know how good Shikhar Dhawan is. I just felt that he was too eager to hit the ball in this T20. He was holding the bat too strongly. That's why he was pushing at balls and sort of not actually timing the ball.
But so can India afford his excitement and eagerness?
We know that if Dhawan plays the way he does, he can take the match away from any opposition. So he's got that talent. Rahane, on the other hand, he's a much more conventional batsman, but a brilliant fielder nonetheless. Bats to really anchor the innings. He's not the type of player who'd sort of take the game away from the opposition in 3 or 4 overs or 5 overs. But Dhawan has the ability just to sort out what mental state Dhawan is in and what he's thinking about, if he's confident enough or not. I would sort of probably risk Dhawan, but I don't think India would do that.
I mean, I don't think so. That could really be better for the team, because they just dropped him in the last game. He wasn't playing that. And after just being one game, you can't be in a kind of really, you could say, mental state that you can come back and play a game, a big game like semifinal.
That's also semifinal. Yeah. Okay, then we'll head into a very short break here on Straight Drive. When we come back, we'll have the toss for you. Stay with us. Welcome back to Straight Drive. The toss is about ready. Let's go down to Nasir Hussain, who is with Faf du Plessis and Mahendra Singh Dhoni.
Toss brought to you by Pepsi.
Both sides well rested going into this semi-final. I've got the two captains with me. Faf, not only have you had 6 days off, but you've missed a couple of games as well. Has it been difficult for you to get into the rhythm of batting?
It's just really nice to be back playing, and as you're saying, obviously missed the first game due to injury and then the last big game against England due to our slow over rate. So really nice to be back, but feeling good, batting in the net, so all's happy.
What about you, MS? 4 days off. Do you get bored sitting in a hotel waiting for a big game like this?
Well, it has been quite boring. You know, you don't have much to do apart from, you know, playing cricket. But, you know, we have tried to keep ourselves entertained with some PlayStation, you know, playing FIFA around, and, you know, that brings a bit of smile on our face.
I'm sure it has. Come in here, please. We're all ready. Ranjan's got the coin, the match referee. Who's going to toss it? It's going to be Faf du Plessis.
Heads. Heads is the call.
Heads is the call from MS Dhoni.
It is a tail.
It's a tail. Faf, you've won the toss. What are you going to do?
We're going to have a bat first, Ness. It's the first time out of 10 times we've won the toss. We're really happy to win the toss tonight. It looks like a good deck. And obviously with the spinners, you know, it's nice to get into the game early.
What is your team news?
Same team as the previous game, so unchanged.
You're obviously come in, but Imran Tahir, do you see him as much of a threat here?
Yeah, look, the wicket here has been turning a little bit more as in Chittagong, so we're hoping Imran has been bowling really well for us, so I see him as a huge factor in this innings.
Tempted to play another spinner or not?
Not really, no, because they've got so many left-handers and spinning the ball into them and five of their top seven as left-handers, we backed our pace bowling.
You're quite enjoying the underdog status and sort of going in under the radar. The team have not been at their best, but they've been winning.
Yeah, that's true. We've been playing some cricket, more fighting cricket really than good cricket. But the previous game against England, we did a lot of good things right. So it's nice to almost peak at the right time. Hopefully tonight we can put in a better performance.
No one needs to remind you about South Africa and semi-finals. Can you put that right tonight?
That's another game for us. We can't let any of those things affect us tonight. It's about who brings their best tonight on the day, and they'll win.
Good luck tonight.
Thanks, guys.
MS, what would you have done if you'd won the toss?
We are looking to bat first also. You know, big game, and always you want to put the South African, you know, to chase the score.
What is your team news?
Everyone is fit, so we're playing with the same squad, no real changes.
Yeah, you've been playing really well. You've won every game. Is there anything you'd like to do better in those four games?
Well, I think we have been playing good, consistent cricket. Initially, in the first few games, we dropped a few catches, but we have got better on that. So, you know, it's important to keep the intensity up on the field and try to save each and every run, because especially in this format, you know, every run becomes very crucial, especially if you're chasing and, you know, you look at it at the 18th or the 20th over when you are chasing, you know, every run becomes very crucial.
Most people have you as favourites because you know these conditions well and you've played all your cricket here. Does that go out the window a little bit in a semi-final?
Well, you have to play good cricket, and also we have played plenty of cricket in the subcontinent, but still, you know, the subcontinent wickets are very different. You compare India, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, they are very different. Pakistan is some of the flattest wickets. So I feel, you know, the condition, still it's a bit different, but yes, we have played plenty of cricket, that gives us an edge.
How's your death bowling been? Because AB de Villiers can be very dangerous at the death of an innings.
Well, we'll have to see how the guys bowl to him, because, you know, he's someone who is you know, at his best and also one of the best, because he can not only play the big shots, but he uses the pace of the bowler and exploits the field.
Good luck tonight.
Thanks a lot.
So the news from the middle is that South Africa have won the toss. They're going to have a bat.
Toss brought to you by Pepsi.
And of course, India are unchanged and South Africa have made one change as Faf comes in for Farhan Bihardeen. We'll take a very short break. Stay with us. Thanks for staying with us on Straight Drive. Just for confirmation that Faf du Plessis has won the toss and have elected to bat. Miss my right decision then in the context of the game as well and where South Africa's strengths are?
Yeah, I think so. that's the right decision and good toss to win. Because in a big game, the way South African normally used to be choke in big games, and it's really difficult while you're chasing. So they got a better chance when they're batting first, setting a target, and their bowling has been really doing good for them, defending totals and the kind of fielding they have. I mean, under pressure, they could really put pressure on the Indian team while chasing.
Only one change then in South Africa in the lineup, and that was that their captain was back in the reckoning, Faf du Plessis. He was serving suspension in the wake of slow over raid, and Farhan Bihardeen goes out. Bazid, you also have been critical of Albie Mokkel's role. He still makes it to the semi-finals. Are you surprised by that?
Not really. I think the success Chennai Super Kings have in IPL, I think Albie Mokkel is from the same team, so he sticks there. No, I think Moni Mokkel, I would have much rather preferred him playing, because with Steyn and Mokkel have been the nemesis in the past series, and in South Africa they had a terrific record, and that's a sort of a mental aspect of the game, and Mokkel would have been my pick. But Albie Mokkel, I am still not sure. They sort of try and strengthen their batting, but if it comes down to Albie Mokkel having to score their runs, then South Africa are already in a tough spot.
India have gone with the same 11 that was fielded against Australia. That was an inconsequential match, and we thought that maybe Mohit Sharma is just getting a run in, but guess what? He is in the semi-finals as well. You looked a bit surprised after the team was announced, Misbah.
Yeah, I think so, because Shami Ahmed has been really playing now regularly for India, and he's been really doing well. And that's a bit difference, the kind of ball, the kind of pace he has. And Bhuvneshwar Kumar and Mohit, they are similar type of bowlers. So it's up to the captain. He has shown more confidence in Mohit Sharma. So it's the captain's pick again.
And the batting order, do you see any shuffle in that for India?
Not really. I think the top three or four will be the same. And then maybe Dhoni will come up the order if they're sort of the time is right. Otherwise, I think they've enough batsmen. Their batting has been superb and everybody is informed. So there's not a big issue there. Left-handers in there even. It's the batting-wise, they look the deal. And if any one of those top six fire, they'll do well.
I think still they depend a lot on Virat Kohli, because he's one person who's really important in this Indian side. And once you can just pick Virat early, then it's a kind of mental, you could say, issue for India also, because he's been their key to success.
Man, yes.
So obviously when you got a main man out, it really puts your team under pressure.
But you've seen the wicket closely. What sort of a total do you think will challenge India here?
Well, anything over 160 would be in a pressure situation semi-final. That'll be pretty challenging.
Okay, quickly, gentlemen, your prediction time. Misbah first.
I will give chance to Bazid.
Okay, Bazid, you the quickly then.
I'd like to think South Africa. I want them to win the semi-final.
Want them to win. Okay, yeah.
Obviously, when is pick South Africa, will go India.
Okay, thanks a lot, gentlemen. That's all we have on Straight Drive for the time being. We'll take a very short break, and then it's a second semi-final between India and South Africa. And very happy there, the captain of India, Mahendra Singh Dhoni. I mean, what he said in the end, Bazid, doesn't surprise you if you know Mahendra Singh Dhoni personally.
Not at all. Just he wanted them to hit the winning runs. Everything had been done by Virat. So Dhoni, as per usual, probably lots of people were expecting him to hit a six, but he defended that rather ungainly, but did the job and let Virat get on with the winning run. So again, Dhoni does the right thing, and most of the times, and that's his grace, his sort of added grace to his captaincy.
Yeah. I think Virat was also surprised when he just looked at Dhoni. Everybody was up there in the circle, and why you blocked that ball? And he at that time just signaled that I want you to finish
you to
that.
Hit the winning runs.
And he was just doing like that.
He was actually surprised, I guess, at that moment. On that note, we'll take a very short break. When we come back, we'll dissect the game further. On our way to the break, let's enjoy some ultra moments. We'll be right back.
Head & Shoulders Ultra Moments, brought to you by Head & Shoulders. Head & Shoulders Ultra Moments, brought to you by Head & Shoulders.
Thanks for staying with us on Straight Drive. Now, your emails are coming thick and fast, and we've got another one. And that comes from Umar Javed in Lahore. And he's asked Misbah that should he have got Steyn earlier on? And what are your thoughts on the captaincy of Francois?
I think so. If you look at South Africa, their tactics, we have been talking throughout the tournament, they are playing one bowler short. And that's, I think, was the main problem with Faf. He's always worried about the fifth bowler. So they want to just quickly finish those five overs, and that's why they gave Domini the first over against India when you are having a non-regular bowler right at the top, and that really gave them momentum. 13 runs in the first over, and after that they were in a sort of momentum. Yeah. And then second over again, Albie Markle is also, I mean, not their regular bowler now, so almost in first two overs India was out of pressure, and then they kept on doing like that. In six overs they were 56 for one. And once in a run chase like that, in a big game, a team gets momentum going, it's really then hard to stop. Even Steyn could not really make any difference later on. So I think they should have gone for one of the regular bowlers at the top. Maybe Steyn could have bowled two overs with a new ball, maybe third over, second over, and then fourth one, and another seamer from other side to just get a few wickets early on and put some sort of pressure on the Indians, and then they could just really just get them out of their comfort zone. Mm-hmm. Because once India there's a panic situation, panic situation, then you have to go after the bowling, and suddenly you just lose wickets and you are under pressure. But I think they got a really ideal start, and after that, Virat Kohli, the way he played, that was, I think, a sensible knock.
Could he have brought in Fungiso for the man who absolutely went for berserk?
I think the team combination, I was always questioning Albie Markle being going for an extra batsman, and today he didn't bat, so they were struggling with the ball. So a genuine bowler in place of him would have been much better, and they were lacking a bowler. I think maybe Markle, even Fungiso could have had a game, but at least have someone who can bowl those four overs, because they were struggling with bowling Dumani, Albie Markle not getting a bat. So his utility was all, after the first innings, his utility was finished. They wanted him to have those big hits at the end of the innings, but once that goes, then what? Then you have to struggle with your bowling. So and if you give India an inch, they'll take a mile.
And there was, that was really a problem, that he wasn't having much of the variety in the bowling, and almost in the last games they've been fighting with two bowlers, that is Imran Tahir and Steyn, and other bowlers are just supporting them. And against India, such a good batting lineup, with two bowlers only, it's really difficult to stop any sort of total.
Well, he may have erred in captaincy on the field, but with the bat, he was pretty good, scored a 58 of just 41 balls, and he is our Master Blaster.
Master Blaster, brought to you by HBL.
Great shot. One bounce over the ropes.
Quicker delivery out the front of the hand, and he goes over extra cover, so expensive the no ball.
This time short delivery, this time in the air. Will it go to the boundary? Yes, it does.
In the air, that could go all the way. Just a one-handed swipe for six. 50 for Du Plessis. It's been an odd tournament for him. He's been in and out of the side, but he's played beautifully here. Short ball, clubbed away. Great batting this, Faf du Plessis.
That's gone a long way. Master Blaster, brought to you by HBL.
He laid the platform for 172, but in the end, it was too low for them against India. Though Amit Mishra went for runs, one man who stood out was, in fact, Ravichandran Ashwin, and he is a Horlicks hero.
Horlicks Heroes, brought to you by Horlicks.
Oh, yeah! What a delivery that! So the second wicket has fallen here. And Ashwin will remember this one for a long time. Almost a magic delivery to get a class player out.
No, I think that's come off Dhoni's pads, hasn't it? Maybe for the stumping. I think he's just walking off there.
Oh, it's in the air now. Is this big enough, or is the fielder's under it? And it completes the catch. This could be a colossal moment in the match. I think he backed himself to clear the boundary and couldn't.
Horlicks Heroes, brought to you by Horlicks.
And this has been a very familiar sight. He comes around the wicket to a right-hander, bowls that carambole and is successful. Today as well, he bowls three caramboles, got three wickets. Once again, it worked for him.
Yeah, always just keep on saying that his mental strength is phenomenal. I mean, if you come in a pressure game like this and the way he just bowls, his attitude is different from other bowlers. And especially his game awareness, he knows that what now the batsman is really thinking, what shot he gonna play. So he really changes his deliveries and uses variations according to that. So it's a plus for him. He's far ahead from other spinners in this ability, like the way he just read the situation, read the batsman. That's why he's so successful.
And the best thing has been that the woes against Shahid Afridi in the Asia Cup haven't had any kind of effect on him.
Yes, not at all. I think in T20 cricket, he's a phenomenal bowler. He's one of the best spinners in T20. He has this set pattern which works for him, and he keeps on delivering it at crunch stages. Very difficult, the angle he bowls from for a right-hander to actually hit him. It was only Shahid Afridi who backed away and hit him over. That was an exceptional shot. In that
extra cover, he bowled
hit him
well,
over
yeah.
Extra cover. But that shot, not many can play, and it's very, very difficult to execute. And we've seen over this T20, all this T20, Ashwin bowling those carom balls right and finishing about leg stump or in the batsman's pads. So he doesn't have much to maneuver with. And if you're going to try and hit him, you're hitting him across the line, and it works for him time and time again. And even in the crunch situations, he just keeps on bowling the same sort of style and delivers it at the right area, and that takes courage and that takes a lot of skill as well. You might go for runs once, but more often than not he delivers for his captain.
You'll be
that's
successful.
Why he has so much confidence on him bowling the crunch overs.
On Amit Mishra, he's been flighting the ball until this game and has been very successful. But why do you think that he was shying away from flighting the ball today?
I think it's the pressure of big game. He seems to be like in a little bit of pressure, semi-final, big game, and he was just trying to bowl fast. That, especially the flippers. But his strength is when he just really tossed the ball up and really let it turn a long way. That could happen to anyone. That's where Ashwin is different from him, because he's mentally very strong. And Amit Mishra, because he's not been playing much of the games recent past, and suddenly he's been playing a semi-final, big stage, and pressure just cope him, and he just tried to bowl a little bit quicker, and he was just
that no ball he bowled, that was quite a big no ball. That shows that he was under pressure from the word go, because you normally a spinner bowling that big a no ball, it's obviously going to do with pressure. And after that, you on the free hit he bowled a faster one. So exactly what Misbah points out, that the pressure got to him a little bit. He didn't bowl like he was bowling in the round games.
Okay, on that note, let's head into a very short breather on Straight Drive. Meanwhile, enjoy some Duck Moments.
Duck Moments, brought to you by Duck.
Outside the line. Major running right across the pitch there. He ran into the non-striker, and here Gaudassin. Just watch your celebrations a little bit. In the air, that could go all the way. Just a one-handed swipe for six.
It's a terrific cricket shot. Just got a feeling it would get to the short fine leg fielder.
No, I think that's come off Dhoni's pads, hasn't it? Maybe for the stumping.
It's hit his pad. Oh, and it's gone off to the off stump. It's gone off the chest of Parth Duplessis. Ashwin picks a very important wicket. Duck Moments, brought to you by Duck.
Welcome back to Straight Drive. Now, there were a few twists and turns in the game, but the turning point of the game was the 17th over in India's innings, where Virat Kohli and Suresh Raina got Wayne Parnell for 17 runs.
Turning point, brought to you by Zonk.
There is the short ball. There is the short boundary. That's what they're waiting for. Six. Short, third man's wide, four more.
It's great batting from India. It's been a poor over from Wayne Parnell.
Oh, this is the over they wanted, India. There's smiles in the dugout now, 150 up. A little inside edge, four runs.
Game-changing over. Turning point, brought to you by Zonk.
And Ryan, I enjoyed the lion's share of those 17 runs there. The importance of Suresh Raina. When Yuvraj Singh got out, we were also discussing who will be the next man in. Somebody was of the idea, maybe it's Mahendra Singh Dhoni himself, but in comes Raina.
Yeah, Raina is in good form. And what I like about him, he's a kind of player who don't need much of the time to just get him. And he just starts from the first ball. If it's there, he can hit it and time it really well. And he's the kind of player who always worked the ball in the gaps. That's his specialty. And that's exactly what he did. He just came to bat on second ball, hit it for six, and then just kept on scoring runs in that important over. And 17 of the 17th over and game over. So that was really a much needed over for them. And Raina did it. and he has just faced one delivery before that. So he's the kind of player who could really change the game in one or two overs.
In overseas conditions, we've seen that he struggles a bit when the short bowling is there, the pitch is assisting the seamers. But here, in these conditions, he's a king. I mean, what clay is to Nadal, that the Indian conditions are to Suresh Raina.
Yes, he plays the spinners. He plays the spinners very exceptionally well, and he plays sort of medium pace and fast bowlers. He has those release shots over mid wicket, and now that he's worked a little bit on his bounces as well, his hook shot. But in the subcontinent, he doesn't get tested with that at all. He plays that pretty well. They go attack him with the short pitch delivery, but he comes up trumps every time. It's only when he goes overseas with a little bit of more bounce, a little bit of more swing that he struggles. But in subcontinent conditions and in T20 cricket especially, he's a phenomenon and he's an asset for India to have him in the middle order and scoring runs. And once he's come into form India again, it's an added bonus. So everything going their way.
And especially the kind of calmness and self-belief these players have, especially Raina. I mean, 10 and over, and he was calm. He knows that I can do it, and he did it easily. So that's really important for a player in a situation like that when you are under pressure. It's a semi-final. In 4 overs, you need 40, but still you are calm, and you know you believe in yourself that I can do it, and that's the only way you can do it.
Okay, time for us to check out some good takes, and that also requires a lot of calmness, and we'll take a very short break while that. When we'll come back, we'll shift our attention to the big finale.
Safe Hands, brought to you by Warren.
Oh, that's gone. Seems like it from the celebration. The batsman is clearly disappointed. Ian Gould raises the finger. First wicket gone.
Quinton de Kock not convinced at all that he's got the inside edge. Here we have a look at the ball. Swings back towards left-hander after it goes past the stumps. Dhoni, he's convinced that there was an inside edge.
Oh, it's in the air now. Is this big enough or is the fielder's under it? And it completes the catch. This could be a colossal moment in the match. Wow. It's gone up though. No distance. Not quite wow. Fab du Plessis takes the catch. Another million-dollar shot attempted by Rohit Sharma is gone though.
In the air, mid-off comes in. Will he get there? Yes, he does. It's de Villiers. Who else? He might have failed with the bat. He's not failing in the field. Game on. He did toss it up. He did take the gamble. Toe end of the bat, Yuvraj Singh, and AB de Villiers is a brilliant athlete. Diving forward. Lovely hands. Didn't bounce out. He's pumped up. He really has been throughout the tournament.
Safe Hands, brought to you by Warren.
So that's the lineup for the final day of the ICC World T20 2014, and it's a rematch of the 2012 edition as Australian women will once again take on the English women for the final. And Australia won it in 2012 in Colombo, and that was also a very just 4 runs. And this is the big one, India versus Sri Lanka. The world champions against the Asian champions. Of course, this is a different format, but that is how it's being billed as the world champions against the Asian champions. Bazit, how do you see this one developing?
Oh, they play each other so often. I think they know each other's game more than they know their own. So there's nothing sort of surprising about what they'll come up against.
The number of matches they've played over the last couple of years has been quite a story in itself.
But India are on a roll. India by far are in supreme form, and it reminds me of the Champions Trophy where they lost no game at all, and again they're on a roll. They haven't lost any. I don't see any stutter or anything. Maybe a Mahela or Sangakkara swan song and innings of utter class, or that can win it for Sri Lanka. But otherwise, I fail to see a kink in India's armory right now.
No, this has been established that India are the favourites. What is Sri Lanka's best chance?
It's going to be really interesting. What I've been really thinking that how they can really win this game. And their biggest strength lies in these sort of conditions. Sri Lanka win the toss and bat first, post total. But against India, they can't do that because they've been really struggling. Their bowling is really under the pump in the recent past. Been chased down bigger totals, even in the ODIs. They've been playing Malinga so well. Their spinners are not having a greater impact on Indian bowling lineup. So I think Sri Lanka will be under pressure, especially their bowling. And I think in this game, they might just go for chase. And that will be really interesting how India think about this final game, what their strategy will be against Sri Lanka, because India also fancy their chances by batting second against especially the subcontinental teams, because sometimes their bowling becomes even predictable and their spinners have not greater impact on the batting lines of Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Let's see, it's going to be really interesting.
Oh, absolutely. Do you see any changes from either sides?
I don't think so. I can't really speak for Dhoni because he surprises everyone with his selection and even his bowling changes. So I don't know. I think they might stick to the same lineup. Tishara Pereira might be brought back in this game to give firepower to the batting and bowl a few overs. But otherwise, I think they'll.
But the man with the golden arm who took the wicket of the first ball, he sets out then. Sekou Ki Prasanna.
Yes, if Tishara Pereira comes in, then he'll have to sit out. But otherwise, I don't see much tinkering with the teams.
And do you see their actual captain, Dinesh Chandimal, coming back into the fold?
I don't think so. They might have this only a single change, maybe Tishara Pereira. But he's not in a good form with the bat. That's why they just played Prasanna. So, let's see how they go about. Maybe they need an extra seamer in their lineup against India. And I also feel that India might be playing Shami Ahmed instead of Mohit.
That's an interesting Sharma call.
Maybe because against Sri Lanka, they might need a little bit pace at the end to bowl those final overs.
Okay, thanks a lot, gentlemen, for your time. And in a couple of days' time, we'll know that what combinations both teams will go with. Okay, then we'll be back with Straight Drive to build up for that grand finale. And at 4:50 p.m., just jot down that time and note that. And we will be building up to the final then. And a super Sunday in prospect nonetheless. That's all we have on Straight Drive on a day where class of Kohli knocked out South Africa and led India to the championship game. Good night.